So today I was in my office. You know, I had those mansard roofs with a big flat.
Chairman Amos.
Are you not?
I'm doing well, thank you.
Right up there.
make everybody a little
But if you're a businessman, you'd want to put your business in a business debt, right?
Which one's that?
CA 3642.
which is Home South Communities LLC. And so I would like to make a motion that ZA 3642 be postponed to the December 30th, 2013 meeting due to the public participation report not being submitted by the deadline. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Are there any other changes?
I'd like to move number 8, ZA 3657, up to number 1 in public hearings. I'd like to make a motion.
So would you state your motion?
I'd like to make a motion to move item number 8, ZA 3657, up to number 1 under public hearings for rezoning.
Second.
That motion was seconded by Commissioner Nolan. Is there any discussion?
I'm curious why we want to move that one, because I think there's a lot of people here for a couple of the others.
Well, but this one's going to take very long.
Okay.
So, keep them working.
Okay.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion to move item number 8, Alan Hammond, ZA 3657, to number 1 on the agenda. All those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 4-1 with Commissioner Bowman being opposed. Any other changes?
Chairman Bowman, I would like to clarify that there is a public hearing this evening for the UDC modifications, including the Buford Highway Overlay District and modifications to Chapter 8. The agenda was advertised correctly online, but the ones that were printed in the foyer do not show that.
Now, do we need to amend the agenda?
I would suggest amending the agenda. Yes.
I make a motion that we amend the agenda as Ms. Goldman presented it because of the paperwork glitch. Is that satisfactory?
The UDC public hearing would be under new business.
Under new business.
I would amend the agenda to add under new business modifications to the UDC.
So moved. May I have a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Any other changes?
If there's a withdrawal, we can do that now without prejudice. Do we need to do that now or later?
You can go ahead and amend the agenda now. We'll announce it when we get to that.
Okay, so number 3, driving group. I make a motion that we allow them to withdraw without prejudice.
I'll second that. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Any other changes? I make a motion that we adopt the amended agenda as has been amended. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Review of meeting procedures, Ms. Goldman.
Welcome to the Forsyth County Planning Commission meeting. We would like to take a few minutes to cover the procedures of the meeting for those of you not familiar with them. For all public hearings, the Planning Commission will allot 10 minutes per side, not 10 minutes per speaker. Please only request to speak if you have something new to add. Following the opening of the public hearing, the applicant or authorized representative shall have the opportunity to present. Then any persons in opposition shall have the opportunity to present. Finally, the presiding officer may provide the applicant or authorized representative time for rebuttal. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments, and please be courteous of others with the use of cell phones. The public is reminded that addressing the Planning Commission or the Board of Commissioners directly is not allowed. All comments shall be directed towards the application being heard by the boards. Anyone wishing to productively contribute is welcome to speak during the respective public hearing. Anyone speaking at the public hearing is required to complete a public hearing sign-in sheet and shall give this sheet to staff before approaching the podium. These sheets are available as you enter the meeting room or from our staff. At the podium, please state your name. All information submitted by the applicant or opposition shall be presented to the staff and not tendered directly to the Planning Commission members. Information shall then be distributed to the board members with one copy retained by the Department of Planning and Community Development as part of the permanent record. The Department of Planning and Community Development is open Monday through Friday from 8:30 till 5. Additional information on cases heard tonight can be found on the Forsyth County website. The recommendations of this meeting will be heard at the Board of Commissioners meeting on December 19, 2013.
Thank you. Motion to consider adoption of minutes for the October 22nd, 2013 regular meeting and the November 19th, 2013 work session. Now, Commissioner Nolan was not at the October 22nd regular meeting, so he will not be voting on that when we get to that point. I make a motion to adopt the minutes for the October 22nd, 2013 regular meeting. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Does staff have any changes to the minutes?
No, just the ones that were discussed at the work session last week.
Okay, thank you. Is there any discussion from the board? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 4-1 with Commissioner Nolan abstaining because he wasn't at that meeting.
Could clarify then, we say 4-0.
4-0. What did I say, 4-1? I'm sorry. 4-0. Thank you, Mr. Brown. I make a motion to adopt the minutes for the November 19th, 2013 work session. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Does staff have any changes to those minutes?
No.
Thank you. Is there any discussion from the board? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Announcements. Ms. Goldman, I believe you have an announcement, or did you already do it?
We already did it through the amendment of the agenda.
Any other announcements? Nope. Old business? None. New business. Proposed changes to the Unified Development Code, Buford Highway Overlay District, and Chapter 8 modifications.
Good evening. I'm here to present proposed changes to the Unified Development Code, which include the Buford Highway Overlay District, as well as modifications to Chapter 8. In regards to the Buford Highway Overlay District, staff did before you put in addition to what would be Chapter 21. This was at the direction of Commissioner Boff. The overlay district itself is entirely within District 5. It extends 250 feet on either side from the center line of the road. The design guidelines before you include landscaping and parking requirements for non-residential uses. It also covers signage requirements, outdoor lighting regulations, and performance standards for vehicle-related establishments. The draft before you did go before the Board of Commissioners in the spring and summer of this year and represent those design elements as desired by the board. I can certainly answer any specific questions you might have after the public hearing is held. In regards to the Chapter 8 modifications, this would include the site plan requirements specifically for proposals that are over 20 acres in size. The site plan must be prepared by a Georgia licensed land surveyor, engineer, landscape architect, or architect. For any proposal 20 acres or less, this would not be a requirement. In addition, for all public hearing applications covered in Chapter 8, any applicant-initiated postponement would require the applicant to pay legal advertisement costs associated with that postponement, as well as amendment of the public hearing sign with the new dates for the public hearing. And once again, any questions you might have on these modifications, I could answer after the public hearing is closed.
Can I ask you one now?
Oh, absolutely.
Is it my understanding that the reason that that we're hearing this is because the Planning Commission, according to Chapter 4, 2.7 of the UDC, that because the Planning Commission may make recommendations to the board regarding amendments to the text of the code? Is that why we're hearing this? Are we charged with that?
Yes, this evening, after the public hearing is closed, we do request that the Planning Commission make a recommendation to the board on these amendments.
But that's one of the duties we're charged with, is to, if there's going to be a change to the UDC, that we're supposed to hear it, right, first?
That is correct. Two public hearings are required. One is always before the Planning Commission on the UDC changes.
So we're not supposed to, UDC changes don't go to the Board of Commissioners before we hear it?
In the public hearing format, no.
No. Okay. Thank you.
I make a motion to open the public hearing for the proposed UDC modifications as presented. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion to open the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of the proposed changes?
Madam Chair, Commissioners, we live in the 7th fastest growing county in the nation. We also have the number one SAT scores in the state of Georgia. We have opportunity in this county. I'd like for us to take advantage of this opportunity. We need to, the citizens have repeatedly stated they wanted a quality county, and I believe in the Buford Highway overlay. I believe it is a necessary tool for the quality development of our county. I believe it is a very modest overlay. I believe it is a quite reasonable overlay. I speak in favor of the overlay. On the second part with this site development map on 20 acres, I know that our county is very different. 20 acres in the south side is kind of relatively, it's 20 acres in the north side of the county is a very small piece of property, but for the south side, it is a very large piece of property. But I also know that this is an improvement on some of the other discussions we've had over this. And so I, too, speak in favor of the site development, the documentation on those maps. I speak in both favor of both motions, Madam Chairman, Commissioners.
Thank you, Mr. Winterstein.
Madam Chair. Commissioner Ethan Underwood, Commissioner Johnson from. If I can, I would like to try to make some suggestions with the overlay on Buford Highway. I think it makes a lot of sense. You want to make sure that we have attractive development. That's always kind of a joke. If you say, what kind of development do we want? We want pretty development. We don't want other development. Well, how do you find that? That's what we always have these community debates about. But what we do have some experience with these overlays is particularly with the Peachtree Parkway overlay. It's a little bit different. Highway 20 going out to Buford is going to be a major thoroughfare. It's likely going to be the east-west connector or in some form or shape between I-85 and I-75. And what we'd like to do is what I would recommend to you is not make it quite as restrictive as the Parkway or Clay. Some of the things we experienced at the Peachtree Parkway was that with parking requirements that you say you can't have more than 60% up front and 40% on the side, what you end up doing with parcels is you take a look at the boundaries, then you design the parking, and then you design a funny looking building to fit in whatever little building area you have left. That seems backwards to design your parking and let it have to build or design the building around your parking. I'd recommend a little flexibility rather than the 60-40 split, a 70-30 split. That gives some, again, you're not just putting the sea of parking out front there, but it gives you some latitude, particularly on a major corridor where you're likely going to have large, big box developments. Also, I wanted to express a little concern about the signage. The overlay seems to anticipate that there will be automobile dealership coming. Again, this is a very, that's the place you want if you're going to have it for Forsyth County on Highway 20, because it's got specific regulations dealing with automobile sales and service establishments. Again, you don't want them to be ugly, but what I would emphasize is say, let's focus more on color instead of getting into architecture. When you start telling a particular dealer that you can't build a building that's your trademark building, I would suggest that we start focusing on earth tone colors, adjust those, leave the architecture in place. Paint's easy to adjust. And then finally, the signage, expressing concern on the signage. I think the folks that have property on Highway 20 ought to be treated like everybody else. And be able to get the same amount of sign face that's in the sign orders. So we just simply request that you apply the sign orders evenly to everybody in the county, whether they're an overlay or not.
May I ask you a couple of questions?
Sure.
First of all, I was on the steering committee back a year or two ago. I don't remember, and correct me if I'm wrong, but talking about the Buford Highway and the overlay encouraging automobile dealerships or something. The steering committee in the long-term plan, I think, called for automobile companies to be put north of Cumming on close to 400. Correct me if I'm wrong, but is that correct? I know we discussed it.
I'm not sure.
Okay, but I'm just to allay your fears of automobile dealerships. I think we discussed that, unless it was changed at the last minute, you know, that was my understanding. I've talked with one of the members of the steering committee, and he seems to recall the same thing.
I'm not certain, but I do know that.
So that could allay your fears.
Specifically addresses.
No. The other thing is, I don't think that the architectural standards on this particular overlay are stringent at all. As a matter of fact, I think there's been some complaints because there weren't enough architectural standards. So I think that may allay some of your fears too, that it may not be as stringent as you may be thinking on that regard. And also, in this overlay, as opposed to the Peachtree Parkway overlay, this overlay is a lot more subject to being annexed by the city since it butts up to the city. As a matter of fact, if you look at the City of Cumming's long-term plan, you'll see that part of their plan is to annex another block or two out Highway 20. So in that regard, when the city annexes it, the county loses control over the architectural stuff. So it's going to be different.
I'm not advocating for that. I certainly not advocating for that. But we also don't want to drive off.
Not advocating for what?
That it be taken out of the county's purview.
Yeah. Well, that's
what we're saying.
That's right. That's part of it's right online. If you go check with their plans on annexation, coming on out Highway 20 is part of their plan. And then the county loses, the authority over that. So So that's one of the things that makes it different than Peachtree Parkway, because it's further from the city and less likely to be had parts of it annexed like Buford Hub. You know, as a matter of fact, this Marketplace Boulevard and Marketplace, that's all been annexed by the city over a period of time. It didn't start out being part of the county, and they just moved out. So my understanding and experience is that they will probably continue doing that. So.
Well, I agree with you. I want to make sure that what's being built, we're all going to be pleased with 20, 30 years from now. Because once you build it, that goes away.
That needs to be a joint thing between the city and the county to work on that. Sure. Maybe you can use your influence to help on that.
I'm just asking that you don't make the regulations so strict that you say you need to drive the business away.
Yeah, well, what I'm saying, I think that's the way it's written now, it's not to be very strict.
All right. Thank you.
Anyone else wish to speak in favor?
Into one chapter that talks about vehicular establishments. I think it gets very repetitive as I read about the same specifics of the canopies, lighting, and all those sort of things reflecting the businesses. time and time again. One of the things that I thought would be handy is versus the 60-40 split of the parking, there is a parking table under the Atlanta Highway McFarland Parkway, which identifies one of the categories as automotive sales. So if we want to look at that as a factor, we already have a table that's written for that overlay section that could easily be applied to Buford Highway overlay. I was happy to hear that there's a delineation of 250 feet from right of way. I did not see that in the original reading of the document. There are other overlays that include some permitted exceptions for businesses, and these typically cover the tattoo parlors, the adult novelty businesses, and those type of establishments. That's something that y'all can consider. And one of the things I thought that was interesting as I read the part on Ronald Reagan overlay plan was the section for those large retailers to have an adaptive reuse plan that is permitted with that. So as we talk about a car dealership or large lot area like that, if that dealership moves on, what is their plan for how they would refigure that space, repurpose that space, and not let it sit there with 8-foot-high chain link and barbed wire around it? I'm not very big on the architectural standards. One thing I think that is attractive to create aesthetic continuity as you come up Buford Highway from Gwinnett County would be that of incorporating some sort of standardized building detail or monumentation that kind of establishes this community as the Buford Highway community. I know on the west side of the county, the equestrian overlay is very big. Therefore, everywhere you see is the four rail fence with the stone pilasters and columns. And I think we could come up with a similar attractive type plan that could be used in part or in full for the landscape architecture along the Buford Highway. And especially, as I said, as Georgia 20 is now being redeveloped, it's going to be wide open right through there as people begin to redevelop their properties. And then, not very big on the architectural standards. They are useful. We don't really have any architectural design. I mean, some of the things I've noted with the commissioner before was how we can have one building, and my example is the Milano Jewelry Building on one corner, and then opposite the corner where the English Shopping Center is, there's one that's totally different in appearance. Thank you for your time.
May I ask one question? I understood you say that it wasn't very clear to you or how to read about the automobile dealerships as to where they'd be located. I read that as it says the area of Georgia Highway 20 and 400 serve the purpose of automobile dealerships. My interpretation would be where they're building a dealership now, my interpretation would be that they probably shouldn't go out much any further than the one that's there. And that's the way I read that. But if and you're concerned, if you would rather us make that a little bit clearer, we can add that to the...
As I read the document, my question is more of, are we trying to create a zone for automotive dealerships to all flock together in this new Buford Highway overlay area? Or are we trying to look at, to use a Honda, an example, what things with this commercial zoning were developed against people's desires? What sort of conflicts with the site planning and site lighting?
Yeah, and I understand, and my interpretation would be that they would be grouped together where that dealership, the new dealership, is coming up right there. That's the way I would interpret it, rather than being scattered down 20. Yeah. Are we talking about the same thing?
Well, and again, my impression of what automotive sales are these days when it comes to dealerships, most people are doing the internet shopping before they go out to visit dealers. So where the dealers that they're looking for are, you know, scattered and not clustered, works probably just as well not to have that area for future blocked. I'm afraid if you have dealer after dealer after dealer where you have Hyundai, Kia, Toyota right down the road, that you really have an area in 10, 15 years as those dealerships move out, that these spaces become big, large strips of asphalt.
So you'd rather see it spread out?
I think for concerned that I would prefer to see dealers, as we kind of see with major dealers in Forsyth. My colleague's not sitting next to Ann Dean. Ann Dean's not sitting next to the Ford dealership. So they are a little bit more.
Well, maybe we can make that adjustment to this with the commission's interest.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in favor of this? And then we don't need to add any. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? Did you fill your form out, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much. And state your name first, please.
My name is Robert Hoyt. I live at 2621 Grapevine Circle, which is part of the orchards of Haversham Grove. It comes off of Knuckles Road. It's about a half mile northeast, I guess, of Knuckles Road at the beginning of this overlay district. And I'm in favor of some of the things in here. I would agree with Mr. Underwood that it's better to have more parking in the front rather than in the back, because a lot of this area in the overlay on its backside butts up against residential properties, including ours. And the idea of having 40% required parking spaces in the back, to me, says, floodlights, a lot of noise and activity that will impact the adjoining residential properties. And I think his idea of 70% is better than 60%. And so I would ask that you make that change. Procedural site plan amendment, and I'm kind of skipping around, on the plats less than 20 acres, I think if it's a commercial development, a business development, then there ought to still be the same requirement for professional architect, engineer, etc. The burden on a business, I think they'd be better able to bear it than a non-commercial applicant. But I would ask that you make a change in 1382E to make that 20 acres or less apply to non-commercial businesses. on the overlay district generally, in vacationing this summer, I came into some towns, and I'm concerned with, I'll call it sign blight. And some towns that I came into, there would be at the front a dignified listing board with 1.2 miles to this business, 3.4 miles to this business, so that as people are coming over from Gwinnett County, they can have an idea if they're looking for something. They're all right there. Something that will tell people where to find it and how to find it. I just think that would be a good idea. I am concerned about the provision here that deals with servicing vehicles, service bay. This would be in 21-11-10, talking about access to service bays shall be from the side or rear of the establishment, and talks about partially screening the view from the right of way. Well, I think it ought to be fully screened from the adjoining residential properties and preserve as much of the existing vegetation on the backs of these properties rather than just put in a few leafless cypress, which I don't think is going to solve the problem that these adjoining residences and voters are gonna face of all of a sudden having, I see that Honda dealer, and I have nothing against Honda, but there's this great glowing thing there, and there's a subdivision right back behind it. Now the property between us and and Highway 20 had the no fast food zoning condition taken off with no notice to us. The time to do anything about it is gone, except we are we're watching more closely. But I don't think that this zoning overlay does anything to protect the adjoining residential uses, and I'm hope that you would pay more attention to that. And other than that, though, I know a lot of work has been put into this. I think it can be tweaked to protect the neighborhood, the neighboring properties, better than what's in here now. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hoyt. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak?
You do understand that this area may be annexed. It's on the city's plan to annex, and it's pretty close to where you live.
Commissioner Buses, I need to close the public hearing first.
Can I answer his question?
Certainly.
This is the first we've heard.
Could you come back up here, please?
This is the first that we've heard of it. We try to pay attention to what's going on with the different governmental units. The city has our water system, but the county has everything else.
You can just check on the city's long-term plan and go to the part where they're planned annexations, and you'll see whether they're planning on annex.
Okay. Well, the planning department here has been very accommodating to us as we started getting involved in this.
Okay. But they're different than us. Okay.
Thank you. I make a motion to close the public hearing. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. May I have a motion for a recommendation to send the proposed UDC modifications to the Board of Commissioners? We need two motions, is that correct? Do you want us to do this twice? One for the overlay, the Buford Highway overlay first?
Yeah, to the extent you're going to, if it's all as presented, that would be easiest as one, but if there's going to be any revisions, anything separate would be best.
What's the pleasure of the board? Do you want to do it?
Well, I do have a question about the wording in the Buford Highway Overlay District. There was a couple of categories that did not exclude residential property. I think Vanessa was going to look into that. So.
I did clarify under Site Design Standards 21-11.5 under C, Landscaping. I would suggest amending to clarify this pertains to non-residential property, that it's state. In addition to ordinance number 98, which is the tree protection and replacement ordinance, the following requirements shall be implemented for new commercial developments and for existing commercial developments undergoing substantial site improvements. That would mean that the landscape design standards that you see within C would pertain to commercial developments only and not residential properties.
You actually have that wording on there where it could be?
Let me put it on the screen.
Okay, great. Including the amendment as shown on the screen. And do I need to read that?
I think we're good with that. It's on the screen.
Is that your complete motion?
It is.
May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. Is there any discussion from the board? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Now for the next, I need a motion for a recommendation to send the proposed UDC changes to UDC Chapter 8 regarding site plans of middle requirements and public hearing postponement procedures to the Board of Commissioners.
I'll make a motion to send the proposed amendments for Chapter 8 of the UDC as presented to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval.
Second.
That motion was seconded by Commissioner Moses. Is there any discussion?
I'd just like to say that I'm very proud that that's moving on up to the Board of Commissioners. You know, it became an issue a little earlier, and I think it would, I don't know that the planning board is concerned about it, but at least the Board of Commissioners was, and they sent it back down. So I'm real pleased to see this going forward.
I kind of agree with Mr. Winterstein on the 20 acres that we need to probably reduce that to 10.
Could make a motion to reduce that. I did think about, like, especially on commercial property. I mean, a 20 acre commercial development is a very large development.
Well, I wouldn't have any problem with that either, and you could use 20 as a Highway 20 is a dividing line between 10 and 20 acres if you wanted to, but I think the Board of Commissioners pretty well has discussed this ad nauseum, and this is what they came up with. So if we send it up differently, it's probably going to be kicked right back to what it is. And, but that doesn't mean that we can't recommend it, and I'd be in favor of doing that.
All right. And I'd like to make a motion.
Like to amend the motion?
Mr. Nolan's motion would be to amend the outstanding motion.
I would make a motion to amend the outstanding motion to reduce the site plan minimum requirement from 20 acres to 10 acres.
Overall?
Yes.
Second.
I think it was looked at, Tom may know otherwise, but I think it's been talked about a lot in the context of single family, but there are a lot of other types of development that's more intense. The 20 acres is a substantial, you know, it's not your a small individual.
And you seconded that motion, that amendment motion, right? You
did. I did.
You did?
Yeah.
The motion to amend was seconded by Commissioner Moses. Any more discussion? First, we need to vote on the amendment.
That's correct.
All those in favor of the motion to amend, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to amend passes 5-0. Now we're back to the main motion, and we need to vote on sending the amended main motion as it was stated.
The amended main motion as stated with the amendment included.
Yes.
You may consider whether there's any further discussion after the amendment.
Seconded by Commissioner Moses. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Public hearings for conditional use permits, there are none. Public hearings for home occupation permits, there are none. Public hearings for rezonings, Number one will be Alan I. Hammond, ZA 3657, Ms. Goldman.
This is a request to rezone from neighborhood shopping MS to commercial business district, CBD, for a gas station and 4,000 square foot convenience store with a drive-through facility with 18 parking spaces on 2.69 acres. The property is located at 3275 Keith Bridge Road, Cumming, Georgia, 30040, and the property immediately to the west of the intersection of Reynolds Bridge Road, Georgia 369, and Keith Bridge Road, Georgia 306. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for Alan I. Hammond, ZA 3657. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor?
Madam Chairwoman, members of the Planning Commission, my name is Kevin Tallant. I'm an attorney practicing law here in town with the law firm Miles Patterson Haynes and Tallant. It's my privilege tonight to be here on behalf of Alan Hammond to represent him with respect to this rezoning. As you heard earlier, it's for 2.69 acres of land. It's actually two parcels of land that together make up 2.69 acres of land. We are seeking rezoning from neighborhood shopping to commercial business district. We are not requesting any variances. All of the performance standards will remain in place throughout this process. The proposed use is for a commercial facility, a convenience store with a drive-through, and that's the genesis for the reason that we are actually seeking the rezoning. As you're all probably aware, you can have a convenience store in neighborhood shopping. So my client, who was just seeking to put in a convenience store, could have simply gone out and put in a convenience store and would not have gone through this process. But when he wants to do something a little more, such as put in a facility with a drive-through, the choices were to either rezone the commercial business district or to seek conditional use permit, and just weighing the options, the decision was made to go ahead and seek the commercial business district rezoning. Staff is supportive of the application. It does comply with the future development map as well as the comprehensive plan. We conducted the public participation process, including holding the public participation meeting. And during the public participation process, I'll sum up for you very briefly the concerns that we have heard and how we've addressed them. One was we did hear some concern from other convenience stores in the area that we would present additional competition to them. And I will submit to you that we don't have a condition to address that. I don't know how you address the fact that your business would be in competition with other businesses, and so there is no condition to address that. Second thing we heard was a concern about the traffic at this intersection. I believe that everyone would tell you there's already traffic congestion at this Hammond's Crossing intersection. What we have suggested is that we will obviously comply with all of the engineering department's requirements for this site plan once it's finally submitted for development, as well as anything required by the Department of Transportation. To put more of a burden on this landowner than that, we believe is frankly inequitable, because the condition already exists, and it's not proper to put the entire burden of redesigning an intersection upon one single property owner that is not the genesis of the entire traffic issue. Finally, we have heard recently, this actually came up after the public participation meeting that we held with regard to the zoning application, a concern that we want to maintain the look, and specifically the look that was referenced to me on multiple occasions was the look of the Walgreens and the Publix that are also located at this intersection. To address that issue, I went to the most logical source that I could find, which was the actual Board of Commissioners rezoning resolution for the Walgreens development. And it's a zoning application 3367 that was passed by the Board of Commissioners on February 15th, 2007. It's condition number 10. And I actually have that if you want to put it on the board, but I'll read it out for you so that everyone knows what it says. In terms of the aesthetics of the buildings, it says all commercial building facades visible shall consist of brick, stone, or glass. Stucco and painted dimensioned wood or cement materials such as hardy plank may be used as accent material only, not to exceed 10% of surface area. Remainder of exterior may consist of brick, precast concrete, split block, stone, or glass. Exterior building material shall not be of concrete, masonry units, aluminum, or vinyl siding, or corrugated steel. That's how we got the Walgreens and the Publix across the street, and it seemed to be the most logical way to make sure that this development follows along with those same aesthetic characteristics, is to use the same aesthetic zoning condition that was proposed back in February of 2019. With that, I'm actually going to wrap up and have a seat. I do have this condition tonight from the Board of Commissioners resolution. If anybody wants to see it on the screen when it comes time to vote, if anybody has any questions for me, I'll obviously answer those as well.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition?
I'm not sure if I'm in opposition or in favor, so I'll kind of speak for both.
Did you fill your form out, sir?
Yes.
You'll state your name first when you get up there.
My name is Kirk McConnell. I own the adjoining piece of property next to Allen's. Those of you who don't know who I own Coal Mountain Builders. I'm a small commercial residential builder in Forsyth County, the building 25, 27 years. I own the strip center, which is just west of Allen's property. I also own the donut connection, which is right next to Allen's property.
Good, yeah, too.
I'm sorry.
It's good, too.
Yeah, it's, I've got a pretty good business going there, pretty good following. I could get up here and speak in opposition to Allen's proposed development because they're talking about putting the Dunkin' Donuts in 30 yards from it. But, you know, I think Allen ought to be able to do this property as he pleases. You know, if he stays in, you know, all the county requirements. I don't know. Of course, it's going to be a huge competitor to my restaurant. It'll probably put me out of business. But my main concern is my strip center. I own the strip center, and I think it's going to raise the value of my property if he develops his. So my biggest concern is the traffic issue. And I'm sure most of you have driven up 400 between 3:30 and 6:30 on any given evening. Allen's wanting to rezone the CBD to put another destination there. It puts a gas station, a convenience store. Of course, we have 8 or 9 within a 2-mile radius. I don't understand it, but you know, if somebody wants to take a shot and make some money, then I think they ought to be able to. Same thing with the Dunkin' Donuts. But you really need to put some thought into the destination end of changing the zoning from neighborhood business to CBD. I don't think it should be Allen's burden to try to find some sort of developer who's going to expand that intersection. But we have a major, major problem with it. In that 2-hour period, if the traffic is not going to want to sit and wait to go through 306 intersection, they're getting off exit 16. And that Pilgrim Mill Road, Colts Claw, is already back enough. And if they want to continue going straight past 17, it's backing up to 306 or the 369 light to go to Martin Road. So I've addressed the situation with the DOT, and of course they have certain guidelines that they go by as far as traffic is concerned. But I don't know if this is an issue that Allen's development needs to deal with, or if it's the next development that's on the other side of me or beyond 306. But every time something is changed in zoning to bring in more development, to bring in more traffic, you're going to be seeing 400 backed up south of 14 in the next few years if something isn't addressed with the issue. And I've kind of looked at it a few different ways, and I really believe that that intersection is creating a lot of the problem on 400. When I talked to the DOT, of course, they say, well, it's a red light at 369. But I think it's more of an issue with 306 and 369 than 400. So, with that said, being a builder and a developer, from one side of it, I think Alan ought to be able to put up what he wants to and sell it to whoever he wants to. But I think the county has some sort of burden on trying to alleviate some sort of traffic issue, because it's going to be, right now, it's 10% of the county, it's going to be 25-30% everybody going up 400. So I don't know, what are y'all's thoughts?
Between a rock and a horse spot, aren't you?
Yeah, I mean, I can't oppose development. I mean, that's what I do, you know, and for a living, part of my living. Of course, the restaurant, if they put a Dunkin' Donuts next to me, my restaurant won't be there and I'll lose 12, 14 employees. But on the other side, and I'm gonna be able to do what he pleases.
But better donuts.
It's tough to compete with a national franchise. It's just reality.
I live to the right there, so I understand everything you're talking about. It's
a nightmare.
It is. What do you do?
And it's
a state road, it's not a county. So.
Yeah, and it's DOT's situation. And I've talked with numerous gas station owners in the area. And we're losing a certain amount of customers because they're bypassing us right now. And if another gas station comes in, they're going to lose even more customers because more people are going to find another way around that intersection.
Thank you, Mr. McConnell, for your comments.
All right, thank you for your time.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else wishing to speak? I make a motion to close the public hearing for Alan I. Hammond. Oh, I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention.
Good evening.
State your name, please. Did you put your form out?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, my name is Chuck Fidel, and I own the access to the right park for Mr. Hammond's property over there. And I'm not opposing it, as he can do whatever he wants, but the traffic study has to be done over there, because it's a nightmare over there. We're already losing 20-30% business just because people can't stop in. Because traffic always backed up to 400, anytime you can go. In the morning, same thing. And he's putting up gas station, 4,000 square foot. That's a big gas station with Dunkin' Donuts. That's not only going to hurt my business, but there's 8 gas stations around that, plus Mr. Kirk over there with a donut shop over there. So, he can develop whatever he wants, but traffic study has to be done before, if you give him permission to put Dunkin' Donuts, a drive-through over there. So that's all my opposition is traffic study has to be done before they can put anything over there. Because traffic is just getting worse and worse every day, and DOT won't do anything about the intersection until 2020. So that's another 7 years.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? I make a motion to close the public hearing for Alan I. Hammond, ZA 3657. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. May have a motion for a recommendation to send the rezoning for Alan I. Hammond, ZA 3657, to the Board of Commissioners. Commissioner Neal, this is District 4.
I do have one quick question for engineering. Just wanted to find out, do you know what this says right-of-way varies there, but it looks like a straight line. Do you know what the right-of-way at 369 is right now? Because I know that there's a engineering condition that had 60 feet from the center line of the road.
I'm not aware exactly what it is. I think it may be 50 foot from center line of existing.
Thanks. I will make a motion send ZA 3657 to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with the conditions as follows. Number one, all commercial building facades visible shall consist of brick, stone and glass, stucco and painted dimension wood or cement materials such as hardy plank may be used as accent material only, not to exceed 10% of surface area. Remainder of exterior may consist of brick, precast concrete, split block, stone or glass. Exterior building materials shall not be of concrete masonry units, aluminum or vinyl siding, or corrugated steel. Second condition, that the owner developer shall, as part of site development, dedicate right-of-way up to 60 feet from center line on State Route 369, Brownsbridge Road, or as additional right-of-way may be required by the Georgia DOT widening project for State Route 369. Contact OPA Group, Inc. for right-of-way information. Condition three, owner-developer shall dedicate right-of-way up to 75 feet from the center line on State Route 306, Keith Bridge Road, for site development or future road improvements as determined by Georgia DOT and or Forsyth County Department of Engineering.
Is that the extent?
That's the motion. So it was essentially, it should be stated so that it's asking for dedication of those, but not open-ended by saying, or, you know, where the extent could exceed that.
Okay, you had indicated up to certain amount. What was going to indicate, what was the basis for figuring out how much would be applied?
Well, by what was required. So the goal was that if Georgia DOT said, well, they don't need any for future improvements, or they only need, you know, 65 feet, then they would just get whatever they need, but it would not exceed that, so that it doesn't leave an open-ended dedication.
Thank you for the clarification.
Was it worded correctly for that?
I think with that clarification, and unless anyone does not understand, I understand.
Is this essentially what their attorney was asking for?
I have not talked with the attorney about the dedication. We talked about a reservation at one time, but.
So is that your completed motion?
That is a completed motion. I mean, we could ask if they would be amenable to that.
Do we need a second first before we do anything?
You should.
Yes. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Moses. Now go ahead and try to work something out.
I'm sorry to put you on the
spot. No, it's fine. That condition is actually something that we were expecting based upon the staff comments, and so that there's not a problem with the way that it's phrased. And actually, I think the way that you worded it actually makes it more flexible, such that we don't have a mandatory dedication of right of way, where you have the ability to work up to a certain amount as the DOT needs. So that works fine. Thank you.
So we have a motion.
Mr. Dale, can I ask you one question?
I'm sorry, sir. The public comment. The public hearing is closed.
All right.
We have a motion and we have a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Jim Evans, ZA 3638, Scoggins.
This is a request to rezone from single family residential R1 to commercial business district CBD on 1.14 acres for open air sales and open display area with a conditional use permit for an open storage yard. The property is located at 1321 Atlanta Highway, Cumming, Georgia 30040. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. Make a motion to open the public hearing for Jim Evans, ZA 3638. May I have a second? Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of Jim Evans, ZA 3638? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition to Jim Evans, ZA 3638? I make a motion to close the public hearing for Jim Evans, ZA 3638. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. All in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. May I have a motion for a recommendation to send the rezoning for Jim Evans, ZA 3638, with a requested conditional use permit to the Board of Commissioners. Commissioner Nolan, this is District 3.
Madam Chair, I make a recommendation to send ZA 3638 to the Board of Commissioners for approval with the conditions as stated by staff.
May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Home South Communities LLC, ZA 3642, has been postponed to December 30th, 2013. The Ryland Group, ZA 3643.
That was administrative. That was withdrawn.
It was
without prejudice earlier.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't write it down. Next is Legacy Senior Services, LLC, ZA 3651. Ms. Goldman?
This is a request to rezone from Agricultural District A1 to Office and Institutional District O&I on 5.47 acres with a conditional use permit for a senior housing assisted living facility with 87 units with a density of 15.9 units per acre. Requested variance includes a reduction of the exterior setback to 40 feet per UDC Chapter 16-4.8E4E and to increase the maximum gross square footage per business establishment to 85,000 square feet per UDC Chapter 12-7.3 Table 12.2. The property is located at 6388 and 6424 Post Road, Cumming, Georgia 30040. Staff is non-supportive.
I make a motion to open the public hearing for Legacy Senior Services, LLC, ZA 3651. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor?
Madam Chair, Commissioners, Ethan Underwood with the Lilton Johnson Department, on behalf of Legacy Senior Services. We appreciate the opportunity to speak with you. We have been working diligently for several months now with adjoining property owners to try to get folks comfortable with we think, a novel use of the property. As I stated, staff was non-supportive. because the future development that calls for more single-family housing that puts burdens on infrastructure, burdens on the school system, burdens on the tax digest. And what we're proposing tonight is a use that is minimal. It suits the neighborhood. It provides a use that's directly needed in senior housing, particularly memory care in Forsyth County, and will make a lot of improvements that we will not otherwise get. In speaking with neighbors, though, we do want to clarify that so the concerns they had was that the original three-story design was too large. So we have are submitting to you that our client is comfortable with a two-story design. With that, what that would yield would be a 63-unit facility. And with that reduction, we no longer need the front yard, the front setback variance. The only variance we need is in the O&I zoning district. You can make as big a building as you want. You have 150,000 square foot building, but each tenant is limited to 10,000 square feet. And what we're asking, since there's only one tenant in this building, a variance to allow that one tenant to have up to 59,000 square feet total. As stated, this is located right outside of Dressage subdivision. It adjoins the Big Creek Creek Elementary and Big Creek Creek Middle School. Now, the question was, why are you coming to this location and wanting to put an institutional? I'll submit to you there is no more institutional use than a school. This blends in, it fits well, it transitions between that school. And one of the things that we've learned in dealing with neighbors is particularly that institutional use has established the traffic patterns at that part of the Post Road. At certain hours of the day, it's very difficult to navigate. So one of the other issues that came up, we said, well, how is this going to impact traffic? And we're going to discuss actually how this is going to alleviate traffic in the area. Now, this is the proposed development in 59,000 square foot building with the port of the shores in the front. This is subject to the Highway 9, the Post Road road line. So there's going to be a 15-foot landscape strip as required by code. There will be a corkboard equestrian fence. So you're going to have a very attractive frontage of the property. And then also you're going to have the architectural standards that we've met to meet the high quality standards that are in the neighborhood. This is actually the original design. This is the first story design. And our original position was there are lots of three-story buildings in the area. Now however, that was a major concern for the neighbors. So Legacy went back and adjusted it. You can actually see, we'll flip back and forth. You can see the reduction in the scale and height on the proposal. This is the two-story plan that's proposed with the four by four cements. Landscaping on front, it's going to be a very attractive facility. We're submitting architectural standards to make sure that you have brick, stone, to again, embrace the equestrian architecture in that part of the building. So what's in it for the county? As you know, most folks, when you do a senior living facility, once you reach age 65, they're exempt from property taxes. However, when you're leasing these in an age-restricted community, the landlord is liable for full property taxes. So you're going to have, through a development, it's going to be a $7 million project. You're going to be generating approximately $70,000 of property taxes annually. And that can be used for schools, it can be used for general operating account. This is a three-story design. And you can see on the far left of the property where the flags are, that's where the height is, where the Tudor freeze. And then it reduces the height there.
Oh, you said there were concerns about it being three-story?
There were some concerns from the neighbors saying it was out of scale with the area. So we Legacy responded and said they're comfortable reducing the size of the facility. Again, this is providing a resource. The market research shows that there are a lot of folks, in fact, our anecdotal research and meeting with neighbors, and hey, they got a mom who stays in the basement apartment that they have in their house, or they're having to take someone to daily daycare. It would be really nice to have someone who's, instead of going down to Buckhead, they have a facility here on Post Road, particularly for memory care. Again, it's stated, significant property tax generation. Something that's also important. We had a transportation summit very recently, and I think it was made very clear that while Post Road is on the DOT's radar, that radar is 10, 15 years out. They have no plans for making improvements. with this development, Legacy is actually going to be installing a left turn lane that will serve not only this facility, but a left turn lane on the south entrance for Dressage Subdivision. Look back to that. Currently, they have a difficult time making a left turn. There's actually two entries. One is next to a neighborhood shopping zoning. That has a left turn lane. The southern entry does not have one. So Legacy has agreed to put in that left turn lane to help the neighbors. That gets those folks who are trying to turn into Dressage out of the flow of traffic and let people continue to move south. And again, as stated, if this is developed as the land use map plans, what you'd really be looking at is another 11 houses with folks making, let's say, 6 car trips a day at each house. That's that many more cars on the road, and you wouldn't be getting the road improvement because we're, as has been complained, we'd be sitting there and waiting on GDOT to get to it. So we think this is an improvement. This is something that's going to contribute to the community. And we have submitted the following conditions. We had to be attaching sewer, make one and two is sewer, and three and four. Left turn lanes on post roads, we've put that in the zoning condition. Exteriors, we'll make sure these are high quality exteriors. We bring stucco, stone, party plank materials. Again, limited it to 2 stories. We've submitted a zoning condition to that effect, so we'll keep our promise to the neighbors. Something this we thought was very important. I said, well, what about workers? You're going to have employees coming in. That's going to add traffic. What Legacy has agreed to do is to limit their shifts and stagger them so that they're not hitting during school hours. Typically, they would have folks come in at 6 a.m., 10 a.m., I'm sorry, 6 a.m., 2 p.m., and then 10 p.m. That way, folks are at 6 o'clock, shift rolls, and the school traffic starts around 7 o'clock. And again, 2 o'clock, those folks should be out by the time the school traffic starts around 2:30. Outside construction hours, we limited commercial deliveries to be sensitive to the neighbors. Light spillage, again, we'll make sure that we get good neighbors there. And also, condition number 12 stated it would be 63 units. It would allow up to 100 beds. And you say, well, what's the difference? The senior living code portions of the UDC refers to beds. And occasionally you do have couples. You may have one spouse who has dementia, but they don't want to be separated, or their spouse who's not suffering from that doesn't want to be separated. So they'll come and live at the facility with them and share a unit. And there's two beds in the unit. Again, we are very pleased. We think this satisfies the concerns of the neighbors. We do know that there's some gentlemen who we spoke to with earlier today, and they have some concerns with the impact of this. And we are happy to work on any kind of landscaping that might facilitate their privacy. We're happy to continue to work with them to amend the board commissions. With that, we'll reserve the remainder of our time and be happy to answer questions.
Ethan, could you better clarify the variance that you're asking for?
The only variance we're asking for is to the maximum square footage per business establishment. And we're asking for a variance of 49,000 square feet to allow a building, a total of 59,000 square feet for the building.
Because we have in here 85,000.
That was the original application when it was a 3-story building. But we put a condition in and we're happy with that.
And you don't want
the front setback?
Yeah.
No, sir. In fact, the only reason we needed it in the first place was not the main building, but just the porch shores, the drive unders. But with the reduction in building size, we don't need that anymore.
Thank you, Mr. Hartman.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in favor? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition?
South County. Ladies and gentlemen, so this don't hear it or not.
I'm here to oppose of a business going into a regular residential area. I've been living there 72 years. We've got enough traffic on Post the way it is. But when you start adding, putting a business anywhere you want to in a residential section, it ain't good business in my opinion. So I want to ask each one of you, if this was going in front of your house, would you vote to put it in? With that said, vote from your heart, not from the pocketbook. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Pruitt.
May I ask you a question? May I ask you a question, Mr. Pruitt? I was listening to what Mr. Underwood said there about if it is residential, that his contention is that it would generate more traffic, and you wouldn't end up with a road improvement. Would you prefer to have? Do you agree with that statement, by the way?
No, no, sir.
You think it'd be less traffic with the residences being, if it was?
Less traffic with residential, yes. That's what it needs to be.
Okay.
If you go back, if it goes on it for anything, please don't zone it for a business. And I will say this, if it was crossroad in your house, you'd vote no too. Thank you. Any other?
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? I make a motion to close the public hearing for Legacy Senior Services, LLC, ZA 3651. May I have a second? Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Underwood, did you want to rebut that?
No, just say we're happy to work with Mr. Underwood. We understand his concerns. We're happy to work with him.
I'm going to redo my motion. I make a motion to close the public hearing for Legacy Senior Services, LLC, CA 3651. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 4-1 with Commissioner Moses being opposed. May I have a motion for a recommendation to send the rezoning for Legacy Senior Services, LLC, ZA 3651 with the requested variance to the Board of Commissioners. Commissioner Nolan, this is District 3.
Yes, it is. This is a tough one for me. I understand Mr. Pruitt's concerns. I feel that this is a good improvement for Post Road. I think I make a motion that ZA 3651 be sent to the Board of Commissioners for approval with conditions as stated by staff. The only change to that being the engineering condition the owner developer shall design and construct left turn lanes on Post Road, State Road 371 for both the proposed entrance located opposite Dressage Way. Why is it Dressage Way in there twice?
It's to make sure that it's understood that a left turn lane would be both for the entrance opposite Dressage Way and for Dressage Way.
Okay. Opposite Dressage Way and Dressage Way. This work shall be done prior to any major land clearing on the project. Also with the conditions, additional applicant requested zoning conditions as stated by the applicant and the variance as stated by the applicant.
And you included the 49,000, that was the variance.
Yes.
I just wanted to make
clarification, because there are a few differences. You're speaking as to what was presented this evening as opposed to what's in the vote.
Right.
Thank you.
We have a motion. May I have a second?
I'll second the discussion.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Is there any discussion from the board?
I had a question about that on the Georgia DOT side of it. If I don't think that there would be any reason why Georgia DOT would not want a left turn lane there, but since it's in the state's jurisdiction, should there be anything that required that if Georgia DOT said no, that would that preclude them from being able to develop that property?
That's a good question. That is their road. However, I'd have to look at the impact of that site and look at ordinance 101 and traffic factors. There may be something that would preclude putting in the left turn lane, regardless of GDOT's position.
Yeah, I don't see there being anything, but I just would hate to make it where that property ends up being stuck. And whether we address that now or whether that is something the Board of Commissioners can address. And if engineering time to go back and take a look.
That particular development requirement would probably be at the development stage. And there would be some discussion at that point. Exactly. Because we always require to make sure that we see the GDOT permit before anything is issued anyway.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 4-1 with Commissioner Moses being opposed. Howard Road Properties, LLC, ZA 3653.
This is a request to rezone from single family residential district res 2 to single family residential district res 3 on 80.97 acres for 109 residential lots with a density of 1.35 units per acre. The property is located on the east side of Howard Road, 80 miles north of Drew Camp Railroad. Staff is supportive.
I'm going to look at these conditions before I open the public hearing so that I'll see what's up here. Make a motion to open a public hearing for Howard Road Partners LLC ZA 3653. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor?
Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, I'm Josh Scoggins with Lipson Johnson. I'm here tonight representing the applicant for this rezoning, Howard Road Partners LLC. This is the second hearing before this board on this particular application. Last month, there was a hearing on the same application. We're having a second hearing due to the applicant's company name having changed around the time the zoning application was filed. That was done by the owner simply to try to more closely correlate this particular LLC with the specific property location. It's not uncommon to see LLCs that have street addresses that are the same as the property that's being rezoned. And that's really the reason for the change, hence the name FRO Cliff going to Howard Road Partners. That was done with the Secretary of State's office. the owner of the company has been working very closely over the last several months with our office and with the neighbors in this area to reach accommodation. He is here with me tonight. And so I just want to say we appreciate you facilitating the second hearing on this application. As Ms. Bernstein-Goldman said, this is a rezoning. We can put a PowerPoint. It was originally part of a larger assemblage of about 150 acres. It was rezoned back in the early 2000s for a conservation res 2 subdivision. When the economy collapsed, of course, that deal fell apart. There were several parcels, including this one, involved in that. And several of those parcels were subsequently rezoned back to A1. So the res 2 plan sort of was basically taken apart by several rezonings that occurred after. So that brings us to the application before you tonight, which is a rezoning from Res 2 conservation to a straight Res 3 subdivision rezoning for 109 lots on approximately 81 acres of property. This subdivision zoning is actually less dense than the previously approved Res 2 conservation. That subdivision had a 207 lots, I believe it was, on 150 acres, we're at 109 lots on 81. This is a property here located on Howard Road, just north of Drew Camp Brown Road. It's adjacent to the Hampton's Grant subdivision. And as you can see from this site plan, a large percentage of this property is being preserved in open space. Even though we're seeking a rezoning to Res 3, which would allow up to 2.5 homes per acre, the streams, the floodplain, and the wetlands on this site actually are going to severely restrict the amount of land that can be disturbed. So only just over 60% of the site is going to be developed, with 38% being kept as open space. The preservation of all these natural areas actually makes the density of this project only 1.35 homes per acre, which is probably one of the less dense sewer subdivision zones in this county. My client intends to preserve all of the property you see in green, including several pocket parks within the developed area. Preserving all these areas serves several functions. Not only will it provide a habitat for the wildlife that's currently there and also decrease the density of the subdivision, but it also provides a tremendous buffer between the Hampton's Grant subdivision, which is located to the south, and the lots within our subdivision. That buffer is several hundred feet wide at its narrowest point. As I said earlier, we've been working very hard with the neighbors on zoning conditions for this. We've been working with Mr. Q, who owns the organic farm to the east of this property, to make sure that we've installed swales along the entire common boundary line to divert any fertilizers or chemicals that might go on his property. We're also going to make sure that we retain all the water on the site so that he doesn't have any issues with lawn treatment or anything like that going into his organic farm. We've also agreed to a fence condition, installing a fence along his property line. The fence condition is installing a fence along the northern property line, Mr. and Mrs. Lau, and also a fence condition, which is not in these conditions, but I will add it. I just spoke with him today, along Mr. McCormick's property, which is to the southwest. That condition will be put on before this goes to the Board of Commissioners, but I have not had a chance to write it yet. We've also agreed to several other conditions, including landscaping along the front, minimum home sizes, exterior elevations, increased buffering and landscaping within this project. In closing, I'd just like to say that the staff, I'd like to reiterate, the staff is supportive of this. We're not seeking any variances to the UDC. All the UDC performance standards are being met or exceeded in this particular project. Again, the density is only 1.35 homes per acre. I think this project is going to be very positive impacts and have a positive impact and set the tone for development along Howard Road, which is a more low density area of the county. And with that, I just ask that you recommend approval, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor?
Madam Chairman,
would you feel?
It came to my attention Mr. Scott was talking that I'm going to need to recuse myself on this vote. I'm not real happy with the way it was handled with the wrong name being presented to us. And I don't know that I can be objective for my vote, so I'm going to recuse as soon as I...
Mr. Fricke, what does Commissioner Moses need to do in order to recuse himself?
He should just step down for the day, so he may stay in the room. It's a public hearing.
Okay. Thank you. Are we ready to proceed now?
I'm sorry?
Are we ready to proceed now with the public hearing?
Yes.
Yes. Did you fill your form out? Say your name first, please.
Yes, Madam Chairman, members of the Planning Commission, I'm Linda Stewart, and I'm here to speak in support of zoning application 3653 on Highland Road. You may remember from the character map and the land use planning that the state required the county. We have fought long and hard for the landowners on this road to have the same opportunity that other landowners nearby have for their land. And we were so pleased that we met individually with the steering committee at that time, the planning commission at that time, and the board of commissioners, and presented to each one of them in some real copy of our report based on data, not on emotions, based on reports from the county that says, for instance, with the from the engineering department regarding the surface of Highland Road, there are some of our neighbors who will tell you it's a very narrow, winding road, unsuitable for subdivision traffic. However, the facts state that in 2009, the surface of Howard Road was completely taken up, removed, relayed. The bed and surface were relayed, it was upgraded, and the Forsyth Engineering Department states that it can handle any traffic now and in the future for any development. There are white lines painted on the outside of the surface, the entire 2 mile length, and there are double yellow lines painted on the center line all the way down Howard Road. It's in actually better condition than Majors Road, which handles much more traffic. The future for Howard Road could be similar to Hyde Road, which lies just to the east of us. Hyde Road is similar and parallel to Howard. It handles the traffic of 10 subdivisions. There is a diversity of zonings ranging from M1 to PUD to Res 3 to agricultural on Hyde Road. Those neighbors seem to live in peace and harmony with each other. And I wish that our road could reach that point where we allow each other to do as the UDC and the county permits. This application has been supported by the planning staff, and it meets the requirements of UDC, future land use and character planning of suburban living. It's adjacent to the sewer connection and intends to connect to it. And the owner has negotiated in good faith with adjacent landowners, met their requirements and their conditions, and we hope that now they will, in good faith, turn around and support this development. We ask that you support it as it was submitted and as approved by the planning staff. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Stewart. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in favor? Did you fill your form out? State your name.
My name is Diane Harney. My husband Bobby and I live at 5115 Howard Road. We've lived there for 36 years. Our property is located just across the road from the northern border of this of the subject property here. We're here tonight to speak in support of this rezoning. As Ms. Stewart said, we fought long and hard for the property rights of all the property owners on this road. We believe that this development is the proper and appropriate development for this 81 acres based on its topography and location. We appreciate the fact that over 30 of the 81 acres will be left in a natural state for the future future homeowners to use as a nature trail. We also appreciate the effort that the owner will make in ridding out area of the beavers so that the creeks may return to their original size and beds. The removal of the beavers and their dams will not only benefit the development, they will also benefit surrounding landowners, including ourselves, even though we are across the road. Our creek runs through our property, and the creek banks are being damaged by the beavers' destructive dams. By helping to eliminate the destruction of trees, the eliminating dams will help to eliminate the destruction of trees and other vegetation as a result of the standing water caused by these dams. The removal of the beaver dams will not only reduce, will also have to reduce the potential flooding risks that result from storm waters that are backed up by the dams. This is especially true for certain residents in the Hamptons Grant subdivision, which was relayed to me by one of the homeowners in that subdivision at the public participation meeting. We respectfully request that you approve this rezoning with variances that the owners asked for.
Thank you, Ms. Carney.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak in favor? I think that probably was it. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition?
Just a couple of quick questions. My name is Joanne Leach, and I live at 519 Howard Road. I spoke at the last hearing, and can I direct a question at the Madam Chairman? I didn't see the conditions. I know prior when you adopted the conditions.
Just to clarify, this is your opportunity for public hearing. The Planning Commission won't necessarily be answering questions.
Okay, all right. I did request about a red seed pad coming out of the development. I didn't see that in the conditions. It was approved in the original conditions, so I just want to clarify that has left in, has been left in there. There's mud in the road right now where they have been down trapped in beavers and stuff, and there's mud in the road currently, so we intend on that being a problem on the development, and I just would like for that to be left in the conditions. And the only other thing is we've been working with the developer to present a berm, and Mr. Scoggins as well, and we would like for that to be considered as well. So I just really want to step up and just say I wanted to make sure that the original condition was left in and not deleted at this second hearing. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you fill a form out, Ms. Lee?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in opposition?
My name is Judy Hare, and I live in the Hamptons Grant subdivision. And our main concern are the retention ponds not catching the flooding runoff into the creeks in the rear of the homes. The gutters will not catch it, the water runoff from the roofs. So we need a lower density home because these homes will back up to the creeks. We need these homes, their backyards actually will run into the creeks, and they'll actually sit next to the creek, and it's a real concern. The lots that will run into the creek, will back up to the creek, are lots 1 to 4, 20 to 22, 41 to 45, and 107. That's in the new development. It also, we have to be concerned about the runoff into our development. And the proposed retention pond, of course, is a responsibility of the Neighborhood Homeowners Association. And the repair and upkeep of underground system could be very costly. And if not done properly, could lead to widespread flooding. That is a very major concern for the Hampton Grant community. And they also wish to view the downstream sediment study prior to any development or moving of dirt, and studies to be continued during construction of development. These reports must be presented in writing. Also, we would like them to leave some of the existing old mature growth trees along the buffer adjoining Hampton's Grant subdivision. Keeping current trees will prevent some water runoff from occurring. buffer needs to be at least 50 feet from edge of floodplain into development. That, you know, some of the people are already experiencing issues when it does rain. There are, it's my understanding that some people are fighting, you know, when we have a heavy rain, it is a concern. And, you know, we are very concerned about that. And also there's the traffic. They're really going to have to put a traffic light at Howard Road through campground. There is a blind spot there. And I'll tell you, it's, we come out of our subdivision sometimes, and it's heavier and heavier. And, you know, you don't, all of a sudden somebody's on you. And, you know, it's really a fear. You know, somebody's going to get killed out there someday. And with more traffic, it's going to, you know, there's going to be more problems there. And that's our main concern. You know, we'd like to have, you know, some fencing, and of course the usual, you know, upgrades. But other than that, that's, you know, our concern really is the flood. That's all.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? Mr. Scoggins, do you have any rebuttal?
No, Madam Chair.
I make a motion to close the public hearing for Howard Road Partners LLC ZA 3653. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 4-0 with Commissioner Moses having recused himself.
Mr. Moses, you'll need to wait until the motion has been, the final motion has been made.
May I ask Mr. Scoggins a quick question before I make this motion?
I believe you're entitled to
I believe that the conditions that were scrolled on were not the final conditions that we agreed upon, the one when I looked at them. Can you start to scroll those one more time? I don't remember seeing, I don't believe that I had the number of homes in the conditions that I received late this afternoon. Number one, I don't have that. And number two is, this is not what I have.
Yeah, this is from the same thing as in the books. So anything you got today, there would be an update to this.
Excuse me?
What you're seeing before you is what is in your books. An email, anything that was changed would not be reflected in this report.
Okay.
The conditions I sent, I'm sure I believe, were the ones that have been sent to me based on the last recommendation. We're happy to agree to the lot cap at 109.
I'm gonna read these conditions. I had hoped to have them scrolled. We can show them.
I think they have the ability to scroll those.
Can you show these?
That way I won't have to read them. Yeah, there's three pages.
Did you notice on 23 where I wrote in the renting plan, just to clarify?
But, Madam Chair, I did not see a unit with it. I'm not sure why. We're not opposed to that unit.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. This is District 1, so I'll make a motion. I make a motion to send ZA. I make a motion to send ZA 3653 Howard Road Partners LLC to the Board of Commissioners with the recommendation for approval with the conditions as shown on the screen. These conditions include the staff conditions from engineering and the conditions from water and sewer, and a list of additional conditions 1 through 25. May I have a second?
Second for discussion.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias for discussion.
On the original approval that we gave, we had 12,000 square foot lots.
Yes, we did. I need to make an additional. Mr. Ficky, how do I do this? Because I need to make an additional condition, and we've already got a second for discussion.
You can either withdraw and restate. We'd have to go through the whole process. I think it's sounding pretty simple. Or you could submit just an amendment to the motion to add an additional condition. Either way.
All right, so I'll make a motion to amend the original motion to add a condition for a minimum lot square footage of 12,000.
May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. All those in favor of the amendment, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? The motion for the amendment passes 4-0 with Commissioner Moses having recused. The main motion is to send ZA 3653 Howard Post Road Partners LLC to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with the conditions as shown on the screen and as amended. May I have a second?
Not Madam Chairman. The motion has been made, seconded, it has been amended, so no additional motion or second is required.
Okay, so we just need to vote.
It's open on the floor now.
Okay. Is there any more discussion? All those in favor of the amended motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes 4-0 with Commissioner Moses having recused.
And he is invited back.
Next is Gary Hodges, ZA 3655. Ms. Goldman.
This is a request to rezone from Agricultural District A1 to Single Family Residential District Res 3 on 9.23 acres for 23 residential lots with a density of 2.49 units per acre. The property is located at 1519 Kelly Mill Road, Cumming, Georgia, 30040. Staff is supportive.
I make a motion to open the public hearing for Gary Hodges, ZA 3655. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. Is there any discussion from the board about opening the public hearing? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0.
Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor?
Madam Chair, members of the Commission, Ethan Underwood.
Ethan, if you give me just a minute to finish scrolling these, I'll open your PowerPoint.
Oh, sure.
Thank you.
Again, Ethan Underwood on behalf of Gary Hodges. Mr. Hodges is here. We're happy to answer any questions. But this is a plain vanilla Res 3. It's located off of Kevin Mill Road, and we're asking for 23 units with no variances. It's property shown. It's highlighted in blue. It's just right before you get to the big curb, goes on Kevin Mill Road, and fronts Barrett's Downs. In fact, when we met with the had our public participation meeting, we only had two folks come. And they were residents of Barrett Downs, very nice folks. Their concern was, well, how close are these homes going to be? Again, no variances are being requested, so each structure will be at least 50 feet back. There is a string that makes up the western boundary of the property. We're asking for no variances to that. And that was the adjoining property owner who's next to that. That was his major concern. He wanted to make sure that there was not going to be grading clear-cut behind this property. The only issue that we've had is that the county has identified this area and requested that Mr. Hodges donate 3 of the 9 acres to the county at no cost for a trailhead for the Big Creek Green Greenway. Unfortunately, we just cannot accommodate giving a third of the property to the county for no payment. So with that, we have been working with the county attorney's office on that matter, but have not received any response. Our understanding is that the commission is no longer pursuing the acquisition of this particular tract, just based on the silence of the county. So with that, we're asking that you zone it with the conditions as shown. I do want to emphasize that this property is across the street from a Res 3 zoning. There is our R2R to the back of us, but the county did approve 9,000 square foot lots across the street. We're asking for 10,000 square foot lots. What we have agreed to do is to, again, require 2-car garages, all underground utilities. We want to make sure we don't just have a cookie cutter type of development with the homes. What is being planned actually are going to be ranch homes to be offered. They have a 2-story option, but what we're proposing is minimum square footage of 2,000 square feet for a single story home, and folks go up with a larger home to a 2-story, 2,400 square feet. There will be a homeowners association. We are proposing a 10-foot landscape strip along the frontage. It's not required by code. And also an amenity, a passive amenity area that is not required by code. These homes will have at least 75% brickstone or stucco on the frontage, on the front facades. And with that, we're happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Underwood.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? A motion to close the public hearing on Gary Hodges ZA 3655. May I have a second? Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. All those in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. May I have a motion for a recommendation to send the rezoning for Gary Hodges, ZA 3655, to the Board of Commissioners? Commissioner Nolan, this again is District 3.
Yeah. That we have to read all these zoning conditions. Can we scroll them again? Madam Chairman, I make a motion to send ZA 3655 to the Board of Commissioners for approval with staff conditions, leading engineering condition number 2, and with the additional applicant requested zoning conditions that were scrolled on the screen.
May I have a second? Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Is there any discussion from the board? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0. Next is Edge City Properties Incorporated, ZA 3656. Ms. Goldman.
This is a request to rezone from Agricultural District A1, the Siegel Family Residential District, Res 4 on 19.39 acres for 53 residential lots with a density of 2.73 units per acre. A variance is requested to reduce the exterior setback to 25 feet per UDC Section 11-5.3, Table 11.2B. The property is located at 473, 475, and 510 Nichols Road, Suwanee, Georgia, 30024. Staff is not supportive.
I make a motion to open the public hearing for Edge City Properties Incorporated, ZA 3656. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. All those in favor of opening the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of ZA 3656?
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Commission, Ethan Underwood on behalf of Edge City Properties. We want to emphasize our application. As you can see, this is what was filed for the consideration. Since then, we have been working tremendously. This is one of those applications that gets a lot of play on the webinars, and have been talking with neighbors and addressing concerns. What we would like to do is to submit to you at this forum that we are comfortable with amendments. This was originally asked for as a Res 4 with 2 variances with 53 units. We are willing, if the board would recommend approval, to revise this to a Res 3 zoning application. That would come in at 2.5 units the acre, which would be 48 units. We are asking for a exterior variance on the southern property line. I'm sorry, that's the wrong variance.
variance. We have withdrawn that variance. The original variance was actually two. It was, yeah, it originally was for 15 feet between structures and the exterior variance. We have removed the variance or withdrawn the request for variance for between structures and solely asking for the exterior setback variance. This property is located where Nichols Road and Nichols Drive meet. You can see it's almost 20 acres. And it's surrounded by some fairly dense development. This is the site plan that was submitted to the 53 lot subdivision. If the board is comfortable with 2.5 unit acre density, we will certainly appreciate that and move forward to the board of commissioners. A lot of concern has been raised, saying, well, what's the appropriate zoning designation in this area? What's the appropriate density? What's the appropriate lot size? And so what we thought was maybe to look at the history of the property. We've got the Riverbrook subdivision, which joins us to the northwest. It was zoned at 2.2 units the acre back in around 2003. But it was an R3, not a Res 3, an R3. That's the equivalent now of a Res 6 zoning. That was our high density development at the time. Across the street, we had the Glen at Nichols Landing and the Hump at Nichols Landing. Those were zoned at 2.77 units a day. Again, R3 zoning. Up to the north, we had the enclave at Twin Creeks. That was a Res 4 zoning that came about in about 2006. Had a density of 3.86 units a day. And then shortly thereafter, there was another zoning, which was a new Res 3, which is our modern category, which was zoned at 2.77 units a day. You can see the developing trends surrounding this particular property. So we think that between the 2.2 and the 2.7 and the 3.86, a 2.5 density makes a lot of sense, particularly with the lot size across the street. We'll talk about this a bit more. But this is what we're asking for, 2.5 units a day. Now, again, we want to make emphasis about the R3. A lot of folks they get confused between Res 3 and R3. This is the category in our table, one of our tables in Chapter 11 for UDC. And importantly, you need to know that in the R3 zoning category, that's where we put apartments. You could do different types, but that was the zoning category that you did apartments in. Now, this particular developer chose to do single-family dwellings. But when you do single-family detached, they have a minimum lot size of 7,260 square feet. And we were just looking at several of the properties over at Nichols Landing that come in around 7,000, 8,000 square feet per lot. So what we would submit to you is that a 10,000 square foot lot is a vast improvement. And the types of homes that we develop here will be a benefit and an increase in property values. Now, one of the things that we have agreed to also is a landscape strip. There will be a 10-foot landscape strip, and it actually will be a berm landscape strip. So we have a 4-foot-tall berm landscape strip. So we've heard people's concerns saying, well, you don't really want the backs of houses or really want to protect people's privacy when you're developing these properties. So this will be a good visual screen on the frontage. We have met with representatives of the adjoining property owner, Acronis, which is to the north. She had expressed some concern about screening, and we think she ought to be very well protected. What we have agreed to is submitted a zoning conditions for a 25-foot buffer. It will be a graded buffer, but it will be replanted along the northern property line. That will complement the screen buffer that runs through the middle of Ms. Ackerman's property. You can actually see her, the outline of her home in purple, kind of hourglass shape. Her home is on the north side of the screen buffer, so she's going to have her own 100-foot buffer, 50 feet on each side of the stream, and then another 25-foot buffer on this side of the property. So it should be heavily protected. What we're asking for are zoning conditions that state that sewer access can be provided to upstream property owners. Certainly makes sense. Again, putting in condition and consenting to a Res 3 zoning, 2-car garages, underground utilities, making sure that you have a lack of monotony in the design, landscape entrance, membership, and homeowners association. Homes, and this is what we think is also a vast improvement upon what was originally developed here. HC Properties has agreed to a minimum 2,600 square foot floor plan. There will be passive amenities, which is not required by code. A landscape strip, as we stated, 10 feet wide with berm, which is not required by code. Condition number 11, they've agreed to three side brick. So again, upping the standards that folks are looking for to make sure that we have a high-end product in that area. Number 12 is our vesting provision. We number 13, this is the proposed buffer against the along the Ackerman property line. And then number 14, we received some correspondence from an attorney by another property owner, Mr. Park, who's to the south. We understand the sensitivity of the members out there. They have had experienced from other developers siltation in some of their water wells. Their concern is, well, hey, are you going to come out here and do the same thing? Ed City Properties actually has a very good reputation for handling environmentally sensitive areas. They've actually conducted what we understand is one of the largest methane remediation projects in the state of Georgia, right here in Forsyth County. They've done that successfully. It turned out to be a successful project. Ed City Properties developed Copper Creek, which is another South Forsyth neighborhood that people are very proud of. They know what they're doing. They're very sensitive to the environment. And we think this number 14 provision will protect both Mr. Hart, Ms. Ackerman, and the developers. We want to make sure that they don't think something that happens to their waterways is the fault of HC. So what we're proposing is that there will be a pre- and post-development siltation study so that everybody can say who's responsible for the development. With that, Mr. Mike Dye with HC is here. We're happy to answer any questions that you have and reserve the remainder of our time for rebuttal.
Thank you, Mr. Englund.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Did you fill your form out, sir?
I did, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. And state your name first, please.
Good evening. My name is Matt Wilson. I'm an attorney, and I'm representing Joseph Hart, who is a large landowner to the south of this property. None of the neighbors have supported this development for a number of reasons. I rise in opposition, but also to urge the commission to impose additional conditions on this. The four conditions that were proposed by the staff in regard to the sewer are appropriate conditions, and frankly have not been resolved, could have been resolved, but have not been resolved. The exterior buffers, the 25 feet on the north is an appropriate buffer, but it needs a berm. The 25 feet on the south is necessary, and there is no 25 feet. In fact, the proposal is for a variance to reduce the south side from a normal 50 feet to 25 feet. This site sits up. It will overlook Mr. Hart's property. The berm is inappropriate. The response of the applicant to a berm on the south side is that it will take down trees. That's not true. There's an asphalt drive that runs on most of the south. That would be they'll have to be taken up. That would be the appropriate location for a berm. So having both a 50-foot setback and a 25-foot buffer in which a berm is built would be an appropriate condition here. The neighbors have tried to work with the developer, but have not been successful in terms of reaching solutions, reaching an accommodation. And so I urge the commission to impose those additional restrictions. This property needs to have a fence on the south and north sides. There's no fencing. Fencing's a safety issue. If you were to look at the map, you'll notice a large pond. There's been trespassing problems with the pond. It's appropriate to require a fence for the safety of the residents of the property. There needs to be light restrictions, an appropriate condition for light pollution because of the elevation of this particular site. The berms, we would suggest, ought to be raised, not a 4-foot berm, but a 6-foot berm, and it ought to be around this entire property planted with evergreens in an appropriate manner. Ladies and gentlemen, members of the commission, the neighbors are not for no development. They're for reasonable development. But the development in this area, the high density development that has occurred in the past, has not raised property values. It has not been successful development. It has caused traffic. It has caused problems. And so a res 3, that may be an appropriate level with these types of conditions. Without these types of conditions, the neighborhood is not supportive, and we would urge the commission not to support without these conditions, without those types of conditions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Rose. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? Mr. Underwood, would you like to address their concerns?
Thank you. Mr. Dye, development about it.
Can you change that?
Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, thank you for hearing our application tonight. My name is Mike Dye with City Properties, and I want to just kind of correct some things that were said by Mr. Wilson. First of all, he said that none of the neighbors support this, and I just want to clarify that I'm not sure he represents the neighbor to the south, Joe Hart, and I'm not sure that that's an accurate statement that he represents all the neighbors in the area. The thing that's a little frustrating for me is when we have a public participation meeting, we had a good turnout. We had probably 25, 30 people there. We have not received any type of communication directly. I had all my business cards out there. Ethan has had his business cards as well. We really didn't receive any type of correspondence. I placed a call into Mr. Hart at his office on Friday. Just to simply hadn't heard anything. He's the neighbor to the south and wanted to speak with him and was referred to his attorney, which is fine. It's his prerogative. But the conditions that are being placed, and when we try to do a rezoning, all we want to do is have a fair rezoning where we're treated like our neighbors. And a lot of these conditions are completely outside of what is normally done in the development. The concern for erosion sedimentation, we have adequately addressed that, saying that I will do a creek study, I will do a siltation study. Again, I moved one of the largest earth-moving projects in the state of Georgia last year without one single violation in this county. So that is not a significant concern. This property is a little atypical because it does not have state waters on the property, nor areas to be buffered. We are certainly mindful of the erosion sedimentation risk. And as a developer, I take that very serious. However, placing these conditions are really designed to try and make this project financially unfeasible. And we cannot accept the proposal by Mr. Wilson to add these conditions. Am I out of time?
Okay, you can complete yourself.
Okay. And I just want to say that for the property owners, the Dorseys that represent this property, they combined have owned this property for 38 years. And that they should have a right, when they have allowed all these other neighborhoods into this area, that I'm presenting a very nice subdivision, three sides brick, a minimum square footage of 2,600 square feet. So I ask you for the Planning Commission's approval for this, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Dye. I make a motion to close the public hearing.
Sorry.
For Edge City Properties, Inc., ZA3656. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. All in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. May I have a motion for a recommendation to send the rezoning for Edge City Properties Incorporated ZA-3656 with the requested variance to the Board of Commissioners? Commissioner Moses, this is District 5.
I'll make the motion as soon as I get to this.
Okay.
I make a motion that the Planning Commission refers ZA-3656 as City Properties to the Forsyth County Board of Commission with a recommendation for approval as Res 3 on 19.39 acres with a minimum lot size of 13,500 square feet with no variances and the conditions presented and scrolled on the screen.
I second your motion for discussion. I have a question about condition number 9. There will be a 6 to 8 foot high and a 6 foot wide replanted berm. So you want it 6 to 8 feet high and as well as 6 feet wide.
Yes.
Planted in between the fence and the subject property. Would that not interfere with the fence?
No.
And on condition number 10, where will the privacy fence go? Where is it supposed to go? At the perimeter, 6th edition? The whole entire perimeter of the property?
No. On the... on either side of the property.
All right, I'm fine.
But if you want to change that, you know, I'm open to changing that if you want to.
Is item 5 and 9 referring to the same berm?
The one, number 9, is on specific lots, and number 10 is, you know, the rest of it.
There was Item 5 mentions a landscape berm as well. I was just trying to figure out if that... So if someone is on against one of those parcels, which should they follow? Should they follow matching on Nichols Road, or would item 9 override 5 in those cases?
Are you thinking of a question?
I was asking.
Well, number 5, about 33 years, and I've only seen one case of a retention pond, and even in the driest of dry times, it's stayed full of water because the soils of the North Georgia area do not percolate, and when you build a pond big enough to hold the 100-year flow and keep it on site, it will not go anywhere. It'll stay a stagnant pond.
Well, I want it to be released. So would that be?
That would be saying the peak runoff rates would not be increased when it's developed. The actual flow rate would be increased. But I believe Forsyth County is already a little bit more restrictive than the state manual on that. Doesn't it have to be reduced by 10%?
The state requirement and the local requirement is that the release rate be 90% of what the existing conditions are. Put it in real layman's terms, if you have 100 gallons an hour leaving the site on existing, yeah, it would have to go down to 90 gallons an hour. But it's a little more complex than that, but that's about what it boils down to.
And there's also a requirement for an event that occurs on average once a year that water has to be retained for 24-hour period, or let out over 24-hour period. So it's just a triple rate, and that's to prevent erosion from stream banks.
We have a water quality level and a channel protection level in the 100-year storm event. And what Commissioner Neal is referring to is the channel protection, where they do reduce the flow of the water on a certain year event to minimize any land disturbance. All this stuff that you're asking for conditions on are all covered by standard development requirements.
That said, I'll make a motion to amend the conditions and remove condition number one.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second on an amendment. We need to vote on the amendment. Is that correct, Mr. Burkett?
Discussion and vote.
Excuse me?
Yes, discussion and then vote.
Anybody have any discussion about the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion for the amendment passes 5-0. We have a motion and a second on the main motion, amended main motion.
Just for clarification, there was a lot of discussion about several of those conditions. As it stands, they are as written, with the exception of item one having been removed. Condition one having been removed. Make sure I'm clear on what's up for consideration at the moment.
So we have an amended motion and a second.
That is correct.
Any more discussion? All those in favor of the motion, the amended motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion fails 4-1 with Commissioner Iglesias, Commissioner Nolan, Commissioner Bowman, and Commissioner Neal being opposed. The board open to another motion?
Oh.
On ZA-3656.
I'll make a motion to postpone. Seems like there's some questions about the conditions and where we're going with it, so.
I'll second that motion to postpone.
To be clear, that'll be to your next meeting?
December 30th.
December 30th.
Is there a time crunch with when the documentation came in or anything like that?
It would be fine to move it to the next meeting on December 30th.
We have a motion to postpone to the December 30th meeting, and we have a second.
Support that, because I like the idea of trying to figure out that late sediment study. We'll make sure that's included.
Any more discussion? All those in favor of the motion to postpone, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 4-1 with Commissioner Moses being opposed. I make a motion to adjourn the November 26th regular meeting and public hearing. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. All in favor of the motion to adjourn, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Were you for that? That motion to adjourn passes at 5-0. We are adjourned at 9:08 p.m.
Okay. 30 is the holiday.